going to read the first six verses and then 8 through 11. 2 Kings 20 and 1. In those days Hezekiah became ill and was at the point of death. The prophet Isaiah, son of Amos, went to him and said, "This is what the Lord says. Put your house in order, because you're going to die and you will not recover." Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord. "Remember, O Lord, how I have walked before you faithfully and with wholehearted devotion and have done what is good in your sight." And Hezekiah wept bitterly. Before Isaiah had left the middle court, the word of the Lord came to him, "Go back and tell Hezekiah, the leader of my people, this is what the Lord, the God of your father David, says. I have heard your prayer and seen your tears. I will heal you, and on the third day from now, you will go up to the temple of the Lord, and I will add 15 years to your life. And I will deliver you in this city from the hand of the king of Assyria. And I will defend this city for my sake and for the sake of my servant David." Verse 8. Hezekiah asked Isaiah, "What will be the sign that the Lord will heal me and that I will go up to the temple of the Lord on the third day from now?" And Isaiah answered, "This is the Lord's sign to you, that the Lord will do what he has promised. Shall the shadow go forward 10 steps, or shall it go back 10 steps? It is a simple matter for the shadow to go forward 10 steps, said Hezekiah. Rather, have it go back 10 steps. And then the prophet Isaiah called upon the Lord, and the Lord made the shadow go back the 10 steps it had gone down on the stairway of Ahaz. The Lord will help me, and I can get the breath to finish this. I'm going to try to share with you my thoughts today that he gave me, the God of the shadows. The God of the shadows. My mother sent me a message this week. How many of you get messages or have in the past gotten messages from mom? In my case, it's always powerful because when she does that, she's been in prayer somewhere. And she was in deep prayer, travail. And she said she had been there, Brother Les, for over an hour. And what she was doing was bringing to God the horrible political situation in this country. I copied it just like she wrote it. The horrible political situation in our country. She was bringing to God the direction of our nation and the direction of our churches and the way they're going. She was bringing to God the tremendous needs of our children, of our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, and in her case, a brother and his family, but family members, brothers and sisters, and all of those connected. And she said, "Son, as I was finishing my prayer, I lifted up my hands and my arms to the Lord." And she said, "When I did, it felt like God funneled all of his powerful presence straight from heaven into my arms and down my arms and into my body." And then she said, "God spoke, and this is what he said. Out of the shadows, the arm of the Lord will be revealed." That's what God said. Out of the shadows, the arm of the Lord will be revealed. She said, "Mike, the arm of the Lord is often used in Scripture to denote the infinite power of God." And she said, "Son, I don't know what the shadows are, but I know what the infinite power of God is." She said, "Our nation needs it. Churches need it. Children need it. Great-grandchildren and grandchildren need it." And she said to us, she had written a family message to all of her children. Children, it is coming out of the shadows. It is coming. The infinite power of God is coming out of the shadows. Man, I got chill bumps right now. So when mom tells me I know what the infinite power of God is, but I don't know what the shadows are, guess what I want to know? I want to know what the shadows are. And that's just my makeup. So I started studying, Brother Chapman. And God began, as I lay awake last night, couldn't go to sleep. I got into bed, unheard of, around 9:30. Thought I'd be stronger this morning. I was still awake somewhere around 2 o'clock this morning. But God began to speak to my heart, speak to my soul. And although I'm not going to put the energy into this message that I usually do for obvious reasons, I want to tell you that God began to talk to me when I asked Him, God, I want to know why You said Your infinite power is coming out of the shadows. Now, I don't even doubt my mother, who's a prayer warrior of long standing. I believe that You told her that. And God, what is the significance of shadows? And God began to talk to me. And this is what I received. Hezekiah was one of the few great and good kings in the history of Israel. Of many of them, it said they went not in the ways of their fathers and they disobeyed God. But of Hezekiah, it was said that he followed fully in the ways of the Lord. He obeyed all the commandments of the Lord. He lived and he ruled in holiness in the midst of an unholy world. Listen, let me stop right here. If you and I make heaven, we're going to have to make heaven surrounded by an unholy world. Amen. Surrounded by demonic power. Surrounded by things that are antichrist. And I'm going to tell you today that I know a bunch of people sitting right here that have their foot on the rock and their mind is made up. I'm going to make it. I don't care what it takes. Amen. Amen. And so he had torn down the groves and the high places and stopped idolatry. And he had clave at one point. It said he clave to the Lord. And he departed not from following Him. And he obeyed all of His commandment. So here's what I saw. In the middle, Sister Sarah, of living right and doing good, Hezekiah had some dark shadows come slipping into his life. Oh yeah. Into his personal world. Outside, number one, outside forces attacked his country. The king of Assyria, they came against him and besieged it, and children were starving and people were hungry and things were bad, and he was the leader. Now, if you think that don't weigh on a leader, you just don't understand. Because it weighed upon him. And then secondly, Hezekiah, while living right and doing good, became deathly ill to the point of death. A cloud came slipping in, a shadow, if you please. The Bible said he was so sick that he was going to die. In those days he became ill and was at the point of death. And the Lord said, put your house in order because you're going to die and you won't recover. And I believe at that moment, that was what was supposed to happen. Because God said it was. A large and dark shadow was over his country and over his people. If I've ever read a parallel of America, I read it in this passage. This country has dark shadows that are hanging over it on many fronts. Hello? Some people think it's this person. Some people think it's that person. One of our candidates has some moral history. The other one has some dishonesty history. There's history on both sides and a nation caught in the middle. I don't ever talk about this, but I'm going to tell you something. We need to hear what I'm going to say today. There are shadows hanging over it that has nothing to do with those two people. It has a lot to do with the end of time and the Antichrist that is trying to rise and be strengthened in this last hour. I hope somebody will hear me. I'm preaching to people today who are living good and living right, but there are shadows that have slipped into your world. Bobby, it's a shadow when you're perfectly healthy and suddenly find out you're not.
Right.
It's a shadow when you feel like that everything you've tried to do has come to naught. It's a shadow that comes when you're told by the enemy that you're a failure, when you know you have lived your best for God and done your best to live for God. And there are people, let me tell you what shadows are. Very simple little instruction here. Shadows are the absence of light. Hello? Now, before you think I'm going to blame somebody for not having the light, you hear the whole message first. Because God gave this to me. He gave this to me this week through a mom and through some prayer and through some contemplation of what God was saying. Shadows is when something blocks and diminishes the light so that there's a dimness and a darkness that exists wherever that object blocks the sun or blocks the light. Hello? Let me give you an example. How many of you love the mountains? I love the mountains. I've been in them several times, and I've explored in them several times. I've hunted in them several times. And Kat, there have been times that I've started on the top of a mountain and I've gone down, 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 way down into the bottom of the valley between two mountains to try to find what I was looking for. And the lower I got, the darker it got. Shadows increased. Dimness came. On the top of that mountain was beautiful and brilliant light. But the lower I got, the dimmer it got, and the more. And I finally, today, this morning, and last night, I realized that the mountains block the sunlight. And the depth of the valley brings the dimness and the darkness. Oh, and that's not all. It's the natural elements of rocks and trees and formations that block the light that's shining brilliantly on the top of the mountain. But the deeper you go, and the more the mountains rise up around you, and the more the natural elements inhibit you, the darker it gets, and the more you are walking in the shadows. Hallelujah. I've enjoyed the beauty of a sun-filled day. How many of you like the sunshine?
Amen.
I do, to a point. But beautiful sun-filled days. And I've been on a lake or in a backyard when suddenly out of nowhere came a storm. You ever seen a good old Texas storm come up quick?
Yeah.
All of a sudden the brilliant light is gone and the skies are full of clouds and it's dark. And there's clouds that have come between you and the source of light. And this storm that comes gets between us and the sun. And suddenly there are shadows that come creeping in. I have felt just before the storm struck many times an eeriness. Have you ever felt that eeriness, that strangeness, that it's too quiet feeling and there's something about to happen? And all around me was the shadows. And I knew that it wasn't really there, but it was there. Because up above those clouds, and I've been in the plains when you break through the airplanes, and it's beautiful above the storm. But it's what creates the dimness and the darkness. Have you ever noticed that shadows fall according to whether you're facing the sun? Hello? Whether you're facing the sun or the light of the sun is behind you. If I'm facing the sun, if that clock is the sun and I'm facing it, all of the shadows are being put behind me. Hello? All the dimness is back there. All the darkness is back there. But as long as I'm facing the S-O-N, hallelujah, as long as I'm walking toward the source of the light, the shadows are dispelled and they're put behind me. And I don't have to encounter and I don't have to endure. And I don't have to walk through them and I don't have to suffer them. But if I allow something to cause me to put the source of light behind me. Look, there's many ways I could go right here. It could be neglect of my prayer life. It could be neglect of my fasting. It could be neglect of the word. It could be some weakness that I have. There's a thousand things that get in the way of human beings. But if I ever allow the source of light to be behind me, guess what? The shadows are then in front of me. And I'm having to deal with dimness and darkness, depressive circumstances, and situations, some natural, some God-sent. But every one of them is because of the positioning of the source of light in my life. Are y'all with me so far? You see, when you face the light, the shadows behind you, and they stay there. When you turn your back on the light source, the shadows are before you, and you're continually walking in the shadows. I want to tell somebody here today, the Lord sent me to tell you, I know that. Everything's for a reason. There's a reason why this Sunday is the Sunday that I come back with this message. Shadows are created in our lives. Everybody say our lives. When storms come into our life. Hello? Clouds obscure the light we want to see. And darkness unfolds around us and it disconcerts us and confuses us and makes us worry and makes us fret and causes us depression. And storms or rather shadows are created when we go in a downward direction too deep into a valley. And the mountains we face, whether they be physical, whether they be sickness, or whether they be financial, or whether they be relational, or whatever they be, the mountains that rise up in our lives become so steep and the valley so deep that all we can see is the dim parts and the dark parts of life. And then we are walking in the shadow. Things get confusing in the shadows. Things don't look the same in the shadows. If you think they do, turn off the light. And look at the shadows in the room. They don't look the same anymore. And when we fail to keep our... We create shadows. When we fail to keep our face toward Him. And our eyes are looking full into His face. And then shadows are created for us to deal with. When our eyes are looking in a wrong direction. Hello? One prophet said, I went into the temple and there were 26 people there. But they had their backs to the altar and their faces were toward the east. They were looking for something new when prayer was there all the time. They were looking for something better when the altar was there all the time. Is anybody hearing me? I'm going to tell you, we fail to keep our faces looking toward the source of all of our light. Shadows and darkness come to us. Hezekiah, your country's in a mess. They're starving your babies. Well, our country's in a mess. They're killing our babies in the womb. Amen. Hello? Amen. Don't tell me about somebody else's sin when our nation is killing babies by the hundreds of millions every year. Our country's laid siege to a demonic spirit, an antichrist spirit. And I'm not talking about Republican and liberal. I'm talking about spiritual warfare here. Amen. Amen. Hezekiah, now not only do you have to lead a city and a nation that's sick, but your body is sick and you're going to die. Let me tell you something. If you've ever looked full into the face of death, you know death casts a long shadow. Amen. Death casts a large shadow. And you have, you look at it and you've loved God and you've lived for God and you don't understand it and things are worse instead of better. I don't know how many Christians I've heard say, well, things are worse for me. They're not better. And we don't understand, and it causes dimness and it causes darkness. Y'all still with me? Oh, man. What are you going to do, Hezekiah? Look at it. Verse 2. Hezekiah turned his face to the wall. And he prayed to the Lord. See, that can pass right over if you're not careful. He didn't call in all of his wise physicians. He didn't call all of his counselors. He didn't call all of those with wisdom. He turned his face to the wall. And he began to pray. Why did he turn his face to the wall? I have a little theory. It's because death casts such a dark shadow. If you look on it, it will depress you. It will incarcerate you. It'll hold you hostage. But when you turn your face to the wall and you consciously say, I'm going to look full to the face of Almighty God while I'm praying. I'm getting my mind off of death. I'm getting my mind off of the end. God's not through with me yet. I'm going to talk to God about where I am, and I'm turning my face to the wall because I refuse to look at negative things and bad things and mountains and valleys and death and disillusionment. I won't look at it anymore. I'm looking into the face of God, and I'm believing that God has my answer. Well, I wasn't going to preach that hard. But listen to me, church. It's so very important. He stopped looking at death. He stopped looking at storms. He stopped looking at clouds. Some of us get so involved with our troubles, that's all we talk about. We get so involved with our stuff, that's all we talk about. He stopped looking at natural obstructions. Mountains and natural instructions are obstruction. And once again, God exploded His Word into my heart when I was thinking about this. He exploded His Word right here. I want to read it to you. If I shut up the heaven, that there be no rain. Or if I command in your life that locusts come and devour the land. Or if I send pestilence among the people, if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I'll hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sin. I'll heal their land. And my eyes will be open and my ears attent to the prayer that is made in this place. You know what he's saying? He's saying, if you'll quit looking at the rain, if you'll quit looking at the locust, if you'll quit looking at the pestilence, if you'll quit looking at what's gone wrong and what is going wrong, and if you will get on your face, turn your face to the wall, and forget about all this other stuff, and start talking to the Lord, He knows how to bring mountains down. He knows how to fill valleys up. He knows how to preserve and to save and to deliver. God has delivered and can deliver at any time that we believe Him. Come on, somebody. If your body is sick unto death, get it off your mind. If God hasn't changed things yet, still get it off your mind. If you're deep in the shadows of a valley, get it off your mind. If you've allowed yourself to put Him behind you and not in front of you, and shadows have caused your relationship with Him to be dark and dim, put it all behind you. If your family is broken, put it behind you. If your nation is in a mess, put it behind you. What you got to do is you got to go to the altar and you got to talk to God, because prayer is still the answer for every single one of us and our needs. My Lord, I think sometimes that we that we give the enemy more glory than we do God. Hello? We don't mean to do it. We're not consciously doing it. But Isaiah spoke to Hezekiah. He said, the Lord's going to show you what He can do. How many of you believe that God will show you what He can do? I don't know who I'm talking to today, and I can't preach the way I want to preach. Brother McMahon, I still believe it's the powerful Word of God today. Isaiah said, the Lord's going to show you. You're going to have to understand. Those who were besieging the country, I studied this. Brother Chapman, they were worshipers of the sun god. Worshipers of the sun god. And of course, Hezekiah was a worshiper of Jehovah God. And so Isaiah said, Hezekiah, your God is going to move the sun back in time. Don't look at me surprised. He's God. He made it. He can do what He wants to with it. Hello? He's going to move the sun back in time. You know what that did to those people who were besieging that city? And they see that if it happened rapidly, that meant it was several hours. Whoom! That went. And all of a sudden, it shook them to their core. Because the enemy of God's people all of a sudden knew that Jehovah God was greater than their God. Jehovah God had more power than their God. I wish I could preach this the way I feel it. They were besieging that country. And Isaiah said, Hezekiah, he's going to move the shadows back. And to do that, he has to move the sun back. But the God you serve, Isaiah said, is able to remove, here it is, the shadow that's over you. Hello? The God that you serve, that you hadn't left His commandments, that you followed fully in His ways, that you've loved with all your heart, and now you think you're going to die and you've turned your face to the wall. That God is going to be able to push that shadow right back where it came from and remove you from under your present shadow. And suddenly, Mama, I started knowing what He meant when He said, out of the shadow, the arm of the Lord, the infinite power of Almighty God is going to be revealed. You know what our problem is? Some of us don't believe strong enough. We got to believe that our God, it's never too late. Did you hear me? You give up on somebody if you want to. I'm not giving up. It's never too late. Until God has slammed the doors of heaven and said, that's the end. It's never too late. God can save your children. God can save your grandchildren. God can save your great-grandchildren. And God can heal your cancers and your leukemia and your heart trouble. And He can heal you of every disease known to man. Because He's the God that speaks out of the shadow and says, shadow, get out of here. There's a new sheriff in town. Hallelujah. Let it happen, Lord. Somebody say, let it happen, Lord. You know what God was doing? Him taking them back to a time before the shadows came with its dimness and its darkness. And God gave him a message. I want to read it to you. I'm sorry that I'm out of breath, but hey, don't feel sorry for me. Just preach with me. He said, go back and tell Hezekiah, leader of my people, this is what the Lord says. I've heard your prayer. Turn around, look at your neighbor and say, He's heard your prayer. No, you didn't tell them. Look them right in the eyes and say, He has heard your prayer. Somebody needs to tell a mama, He heard your prayer. I said, somebody needs to tell a grandmother, He heard your prayer. He heard your prayer. And He's seen your tears. Hello? This next part I love. I'm going to heal you. It's going to be all right, Hezekiah. I will heal you. On the third day from now, what you need to do, this is the best part of my message, is stop whining and go back to church. Stop feeling sorry for yourself and go back to church. Reach up and dry. No, you can't dry your tears. He's already dried them. He said He saw them. And if He sees them, He's going to dry them. But it's time for you not to wallow in that shadow and wallow in that valley and wallow in your problem. Well, I'm just broke all to pieces. No, you're not. You barely cracked. And the healer's already said, I'm going to take care of it. Now you go back to church. You go back to worship. You go back to prayer. You go back to where you belong. This is what I'm going to do. Now you do what you can do. Oh, my Lord, my Lord. And I'll deliver you. This is the second thing. Everybody say number two. I'll deliver you and this city from the hand of the Assyrians. And I will defend this city for my sake. Close your eyes with me. Don't dare one person look around. How many of you have had some shadows worrying you? Hold your hand up. I know I'm right on track then. Almost every hand in this building. I got a message for you. I've heard you. Now go back to church. I've heard you go back to worship. I've heard you go back to your faith. Don't talk about your shadow. Talk about your faith. Talk about your healing. Talk about your goodness of God. Talk about the things that God can do. I've seen your tears. I'm going to heal you. Now, just go on about your business. That's what He's saying. Just go on being a child of God. Just go on being a believer. Just go on confessing to the Lord that He is the great God of our salvation. And then, Brother Les, I believe this for me and you because we both care a whole lot. The next thing He's going to do, He's going to heal our land. Did you hear me? He's going to heal our land. He is God supreme. He is God all the time. He's God on the platform. He's God back at the door. He's God in the amen corner, and He's God forevermore. He's God today. He's God tomorrow. He was God yesterday, and He always will be God. And we all need to quit worrying and let God be God. But He said, I want you to go to praise, go to worship, go to prayer. I want you to turn your face to the wall and give me thanks for the years I'm going to add, for the children I'm going to save, for the grandchildren I'm going to bring. Look, I'm a grandpa. I'm a father. I worry a lot, and I admit it. But the Lord said to me in this, you stop your worrying. Go back and preach. Go back and believe. Go back and pray. Go back and do what you know to do. I am the God of the shadows. I'm the God of the shadows. I wonder what you and I may have allowed to cause God to be behind us and not ahead of us, in front of us. What have we done to walk too far into the depth of a valley? What have we done to let the storm change our course? It's not fatal, and it's not final. It's just simply a lack of understanding on our part. You know, if it was up to me, I've seen times when I was a teenager and I wanted to play a ball tournament so bad, Brother Ronnie, and the stinking rain hadn't rained in 2 months, and here it comes the day of my tournament. And I look out the door and say, God, if you just let it lighten up, I'll play in the sprinkle. I'll play in the rain. If I was God, I'd stop this rain. Guess what I've learned? I'm not God. And I can't stop the rain. And you're not God. And you can't make your storm better. And you can't make your valley more shallow. All you can do is head up that mountain and get on up to the top where the sun's shining and where the shadows are gone and where the God of glory is reigning in power. Oh, my Lord, my Lord. Brother Terry, I feel like running, but my body says no. How many of you feel what I'm talking about? Stand up with me right now if you feel what God wants to do. Now, here's what we're doing for an altar call. We're fixing to cast out some shadows. I'm not, you are. I want you to turn your face to the wall in your own mind. And I want you to let God know in the end of this service, I'm not going to fret anymore. I'm not going to worry anymore. I'm not going to let this make me a different person anymore. I don't know about y'all, but when I get worried, I get grumpy. I don't. It changes my personality when I let stuff get the best of me. I don't want to be that way, Brother Chapman. I don't want to be that way. I want to turn my face to the wall and say, you're the God of shadows. All you got to do is just put your hand out there and move time back. Would you believe me as a pastor if I told you something? God wants to turn back the hands of time to a time before your latest shadow, so that you're not under that shadow. And your faith in God is going to help you to become what He had plans for all along. But the devil knows if he can get it dim and dark in your world, it'll change you and it'll change your faith in God. But we're not going to do that. Everybody say, He's the God of the shadows.